by putting each plant, one plant, single plant per hill, and allowing a distance of 25 centimeter to 25 centimeter between line and between rows. And this makes it possible to do the weeding also using a weeder. And this weeder, in normal kind of agricultural practice, the weed is removed. Here it is plowed back into the soil, so enriching the soil further, and in the process aerates the land, soil, and root zone of the plants also gets strengthened. There are many, okay, I should not go in deep into the SRI, but this is a system which has resulted in 40 to 80% higher yield. It has, it reduces, it has got a tremendous drought coping mechanism, because you are using 1/10 the population. So your requirement of seed is 1/10 of the normal kind of cultivation. So thereby, if there is a delay in onset of monsoon, you can go, the farmer can go for a second or a third nursery, staggered nursery. So that's a climate resilient point of view. And thirdly, it also emits 60% less methane than normal kind of paddy grown under water stagnating conditions. Here the water is not kept continuously, the paddy is not under continuous submerges, but alternate wetting and drying, so that kind of a thing. Besides that, we have quite a lot of planning activities cross-sectoral, which we have, which will make it possible to reduce impact of production, various production sectors on the marine life, and that is how it will reduce the pressure on the marine life. Thank you.
My name is Suresh Sahu, and my roots are from a small village in Orissa. I've been out of Orissa for the last 52 years, and 35 of which has been a corporate life. Currently, I pursue my personal life, and the reason I'm here with Kiran and Edubro is to basically find synergies as to how I can provide my services for a better cause. The takeaway from this session is I would like to look at certain challenges that are related to the tribal issues, and if there is a cause for me to participate and help the tribal people or any of your forums, I'll be more than happy to do that.
David from Habitat for Humanity. We have a vision of providing a decent shelter to the poor people. And we have interventions of new houses, repairing houses, and also sanitation, providing sanitation units to the poor. We have our main work in the tribal area, in the rural area. And nowadays we are developing a strategy of how we can help these tribal people for housing plus what else do they require, like livelihood solutions, or in anything, how we can help them more. So that I would like to learn today from you guys. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Abha Vijayan. I also work with Habitat for Humanity India. I am manager legal for them. And as David said, we intervene all over India, across tribes, across cross sectors. And as he said, we provide housing, shelter, sanitation, and everything. And right now, we are working on a strategy of impacting 50 villages across all over India for whom we have collected data. And our intervention won't just be limited to housing, but it would cover livelihood, education, sanitation, and all other aspects of their life to help them develop in a very, very positive manner. And we would just, as he said, interested in you know, gaining what all information we can from here. Thank you so much.
I am Soma Ghosh. At the moment, I am not working anywhere. Basically, I've just come here to gain knowledge. And of course, I had done a course on social entrepreneurship, but I have not worked after that. And before that, I was working for Samsung India Electronics for some years. and also with Eureka Forbes. And basically I've come here to gain knowledge and find out if I could be of any help or any, if I could do any good to any of you. Thank you.
I mentioned, which people spoke about, was the education and training area. But what was more heartening was to see that there were a large number of people here that had a lot of common ground in terms of either skills and resources or experiences. And a lot of them have volunteered to participate in cross activities. I'm wondering whether anyone has a very specific requirement which they would like to kick off and say that, you know, we'd like to discuss that and put that kind of a requirement on the table, and we start with that as a point of discussion and take it from there. I feel that might be a way. Does any of you have any particular project or experience that you want to share which we can use as the starting point for a discussion? Chandrasekhar, you had something specific. Sorry.
I would like to put the issue change of culture and uprooting of tribal people from their own habitat and culture as one of the themes. Because development doesn't necessarily mean that you have infrastructure or some money in your pocket. But it has also to do with your dignity, the place you live in. So whatever we do, whether it is livelihood, whether it is shelter, whether it is education, whether we are trying to uproot these people from their habitat and their cultural traditions, or we are trying to somehow negotiate with these components and trying to find out a middle way ground or way out. So this can be a theme. Then we start with whatever experiences we have with each of the components, say livelihood, education, land issues, and other things.
So the point you raised is the point that Chandrasekhar, or we call him Shekhar for short, has raised earlier, in fact, in off-site discussions. So Shekhar, would you like to kick off? Because he is very, very sensitive, very keen to discuss this very perspective that you have raised, particularly here. So Shekhar, I leave it to you too.
Hello. I'm talking more out of my feelings and experiences from 1973. I was an innocent boy, middle class boy from Hyderabad, thinking that I am educated, I know English, I can develop tribals. And I know law, they don't know law. So if the law is not delivered goods to them, I will help them to get justice in the court. To date, I could not get one justice. In the 40 years, I could not get one justice in the court of law. We could get it in the village. We could get the justice in the village community, not in the court of law. It was very expensive, harassing. Then when I entered, the first 4 or 5 years, I found I don't know their language. I was always lived in cities. Then going into the village and living, very difficult it was for some years. Once I started in 76, they started supporting me, the villagers. The question of volunteerism, Baba Amte always used to say, live with the people, the ideas come out. Sharing is volunteerism. And we got an idea of education, what was needed. Like everyone, I was a boy that time, the boys in the village sitting together. Then we discussed, we have school. Then all the people put together, without money, put a shed. It took 8 months to put a small shed. It took 8 months. But they did it, and they provided food. Now this kind of activities were building up. From 77, we started getting funds. I do not know even today, I do understand, I'm in a confusion. Whether funds are a blessing or otherwise. Because the community, the young people were around me at that time. I was a small hero with them. Every one of us were boys and girls. About 24 of us were there in the team. I was only one non-tribal, all the other tribals. And the team was working out very well. No accounts, no audit, no fighting, no signature, nothing. We could actually make about, in those years, about 4,000 to 5,000 every month. The actual quantification, if you take, much more than that. So once the money comes, now when I look back, in these 30 years, as voluntary organization we started, with some zeal, marching ideas, their ideas. Now it has become so much professionalized. And interestingly, I see that we have become so much professionalized, and we are also, the work which we are doing as is something like oil in the water, the work. And this danger I realized in the past 20 years, 10 years before. Earlier, all the organizations used to come together. When there was an issue, we had one yatra from Parvatipuram to Polavaram, 300 kilometers, about 240 of us walking, young boys and girls, from about 40 organizations. No emails, even the, not the cell phone. Still we could communicate, interact, and plan the details and work. With very less funding, about 20,000 to 30,000 we got for 200 of us, spending about 2 months. We ate in the villages. But the first time I found a jolt, and I realized that we lost the sensitivity with the communities. And also the communities have become alien to themselves with a lot of money, projects. People who were with me, they all got married, they got shipped out. And the anger was coming. The whole sort of the shift going on. And then I realized something. Then the question, great matter. Because when our friend was talking about culture, because when holistic education, which government is also doing, some schools, the other schools also, is it really holistic? How is it they lose their foot on the culture? And with the holistic education, if some, they go for jobs outside and cannot explore possibilities in the village, in their village. And if they cannot feel pride of being tribal, I so feel the big sentiment of this one. When I feel I'm proud of being with them, but many like they want to get converted into non-tribals.
Proud to be associated with it, and I'm sure we can modify this into several other projects with modifications. We would love to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ali. Good afternoon, friends. It's very interesting with the few introductions which I have received. I represent WWH. This is We Will Help Charitable Foundation. We work in the interiors of RA Colony. There are 27 padas or hamlets within RA Colony with a total population of about 1,10,000. It's very interesting what I have just spoken. There are a lot of takeaways that I can already see coming through within this roundtable. We have been working with the women in RA Colony, the skills on what they possess, and we've been conducting tribal lunches and inviting people from Mumbai and surrounding cities to come and have in the midst of the tribal jungles of RA. So I would love to hear more from you on how we could actually see their village, their hamlets, and them not being displaced, because it's a burning issue as we speak as of date. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Pooja, and I'm from the CSR Journal, a web news portal in the CSR domain. I'm just here to hear and observe the thoughts coming from all of you.
Good afternoon. I'm Tushar Kanti Senapati, and I'm from Kalinga Institute of Social Sciences. As you know, today morning our founder was there and he spoke about the organization. This organization is nothing but to provide holistic education, along with that livelihood opportunities to the poorest of the poor tribal children. We have right now 25,000 plus children in our institute, and the education is given free of cost. since these children are special in terms of not only they need education, they need other aspects, other things for their studies. When we talk about tribal welfare and education for a tribal child, it also includes a lot of other things along with it. For example, we have a lot of malnutrition in Orissa. So we thought of malnutrition. There are many diseases like anemia and other things. So we give nutritious lunch, dinner, breakfast to them. We take care of their health facilities through our dispensary. We have a big medical college along with that, around 2,000 bedded hospital, wherein if there is any serious ailment, then these students are taken to that medical college. Then we also look after their livelihood opportunities in terms of giving them vocational training. And we also give professional training to them. For example, I'll come to that later on and expand it more elaborately. So we also give them professional education free of cost. And likewise, we also deal with lot of, actually we base ourselves on need-based assumption that tribal POS to children need special care and special things in their life. For example, they need to know initial years of their life, they have to be taught in their own mother tongue. And research has shown that if they are taught in their own mother tongue, they have good cognitive levels. Moreover, they are attached to their culture. So likewise, a lot of things are there, a lot of projects are running in order to give holistic education to these children. And what I look forward from this conference is I would like to take best practices from whoever agencies or organizations who are working on education. And as I told you, education is not only about giving classroom lecture. It has a lot to do with nutrition, it has a lot to do with their culture, it has a lot to do with the jobs, the livelihood, and likewise. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon. I just stepped in. I'm sorry for being late. I'm an industrial designer, and I've been living here for 2 years, and I'm researching sanitation. And it connects very well to what you said, sir, that education is not only, being in school and education is not only the academics, but also sanitation in the schools. So I've been to quite a few villages in rural India where sanitation is lacking, and I've seen some projects that are being built as well. And what I'm very interested is in seeing what works and what doesn't work, and where there's a bigger need, and what can be done, and of course how design might be mitigating some cultural barriers. So I would be very happy to connect and, you know, get to know of other projects or things that might relate to sanitation. I've been also designing a little bit, and I'm teaching here, but I'm very much into researching this field, which I think is fascinating. So, thank you. Oh, and I didn't mention my name, Tamar Akov. Nice to meet you.
Thanks, Tamara. So I'm Anil Saldana. By profession, I'm in logistics infrastructure, and by passion, I'm very fond of design and product design. I first got exposed to the area of Adivasi issues a couple of months ago when I met a couple of Gandhians, activists, including Shekhar, was at that forum. And one of the things Shekhar mentioned was that, we need to have a connect with people in the cities so that they have a better appreciation of what we are and our lifestyle, and what resources can then be brought to support their initiatives. 2 weeks ago, I visited Mendaleka in Gachiroli, and it's a marvelous experience for me to see how they have moved towards securing their rights under the Constitution and the Forest Act and various other regulations, and what were the other self-supporting mechanisms they had established for themselves, particularly in relation to governance. A couple of examples. One is that they have a Gram Sabha, which is their own village Gram Sabha, not part of the Panchayat. They make all decisions through unanimous agreement. There is nothing that's not agreed unanimously. They have all donated their lands back to the Gram Sabha. So that means there can be no sale of lands to third party because the Gram Sabha owns it. And they till their own land. They have a system wherein they determine the price through market mechanisms for the sale of bamboo. They don't sell it back to the forest department, but they go out on tender. So they have come up with various little arrangements, including, I think, if I'm not mistaken, they are the first village to secure community participation, forest management under the new act. So for me, that was quite a learning experience. What have I come here is that taking on from where Shekhar mentioned, what is it that we could do here? I thought this could be a forum where we could discuss using the resources that are available here and see if there's a project that we can take forward after this roundtable.
Good afternoon. I am Malini, working with the Vishakhapatnam tribals, Andhra Pradesh. I've been working in this field last 20 years. I was involved in many projects like irrigation, education, even forest related activities, but for last 5 years we have been working with the youth and women. Especially we feel, I've been listening a word when I started my career, tribals don't know anything, they don't have awareness. Every government department and even outsiders will tell that, but we feel they have their own traditional knowledge, technical knowledge, and they can deal their issues. But when they want to compete the so-called outside world mainstream, they need to learn something. Earlier days, there was no literacy rate at all, just 3%, 4% in our area. Now, youth are becoming educating and they are graduating. Irrespective of their standards, there are so many educated youth in the village, and they are able to tell their problems. Whenever organization goes to a village or any government official or any politician, they are able to tell about their problems. As an organization, we are questioning them. You are very much aware of your problem, and you are educated youth having your own time to spend in your village. What can you do for your village? If you are not ready, why should we come and do? If you don't know how to do, we are there to facilitate you. If you are not ready, we are also not at all interested. This is our approach with the youth, and if they are really interested, they can come to us to learn the things. We give them some trainings, especially in the legal aspects, Forest Rights Act, RTA, PESA, and other things. And we tell them so many government schemes and government orders, and so that they can know what scheme is going on in their village, as per rule it is going on or not. If anything goes wrong, how can they question the government or negotiate with the government or fight by using their legal remedies and all. And besides this, we are also having a legal advice, the desk for women issues. But the present focus is, right now we feel, to solve the village level issues, be it from the self-governance or even to become a self-reliant, everything youth can do. There is a potential youth in the village, and they have to learn the skills to develop their own income by using their own resources. And we believe even people should not make that these people are not aware and all. They need to be self-equipped with knowledge for their personal development, and they have to be responsible to develop their community. And third thing is they have to generate their own income. If these three things are there, they can become strong and nobody can easily comment on them. So we want to work for their holistic development. And here I want to tell one more point. And every village, there are so many committees. Government is introducing watershed committee or mother and child committee, education committee, and organizations like us also going with an activity and forming so many committees. All these committees are not at all thinking in holistic way. Everyone think their own activity, they feel superior, or at times they don't have even interest about the activity, just for the namesake on papers they sign like that. So there is a need to have a vibrant youth group in the village who can think in a holistic way of their village development, and at the same time they can also give their full support to their own panchayat president and all. So with this idea we came here, and I am happy to share my thoughts, and at the same time I want to listen your thoughts. Hope I can get good feedback, support, and any new ideas in whichever way you can support, I am here to take it. Thank you.
Hello friends, I'm Alvin D'Souza. I represent Annada. Annada in Sanskrit means giving food. So we are an organization that has expertise in developing food solutions for various mass feeding programs. On the same lines, we are right now serving around 1,500 beneficiaries, which includes pregnant mothers, lactating mothers, and children from the age group of 6 months to 6 years in 28 Anganwadis of Jawhar Taluka, which is predominantly a tribal block, with the clear focus of providing and addressing the issue of nutrition in that particular community. The reason why I am here and the thing that I look at as a takeaway is to see how we could collaborate with the wonderful work that all the people who have been sharing till date are doing, and look at how we can add on to your existing initiative that you guys are taking up with regards to nutrition. So that's something that I look at as a takeaway with regards to the organizational point of view. On a personal point, as Mr. Anil was saying, that he visited Mendaleka last week, right? So I had visited Mendaleka in 2002. So I know about that village and how that village together has come up, you know, and I have been witnessing their journey. So I have been following up on their journey from the time when Mr. Devaji Tofa must have met him. So he was, as a young person, whenever there was a four-wheeler that used to come into the village, he used to just run away and go and sit in his house. And the transformation that the village has shown in saying that this is our land, this is our forest, and we own it as a, you know, unit together. I think there's a lot of learnings for us. You know, we say that we need to get them into the mainstream. I have a different contention. I would say that mainstream society needs to learn from these kind of tribal communities, where they have said that I take ownership of the land. And when I was there as a student. I was doing my graduation at that point in time. And when we were walking with him in the forest, he used to tell us that this is a bamboo plant, and if anyone wants to come and cut bamboo, he has to first take permission at the Gram Sabha and then go and cut it. And if he cuts bamboo, then he has to also go and plant bamboo. So all the things that we are talking about, sustainability, eco-friendly, environment-friendly, conservation, and all of those aspects, so these things are ingrained in this community there. So I think there's a lot of things that we can learn from them. So as a learner, I sit here today. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Kade Soren, and I'm also from Kalinga Institute of Social Sciences. I'll tell few things which Tusar has not mentioned. As we are now more than 25,000 children in the one campus, we are planning to establish almost 16 different schools in 16 different tribal dominated districts in Orissa. Not only tribal from Orissa we are imparting education, there are tribal from Jharkhand, the tribal from Northeast. So we are educating them, and we are also empowering them in terms of different jobs or different industry oriented trainings, you know. Two things I would like to tell here. We are also working with the tribal leaders in different districts, as we have established office in different 16 different tribal dominated district in Orissa. So we are working with the tribal leaders out there, and how, with the help of education, how we can aware people in the different issues of tribal. I am here to learn about you know, different practices across the country, and also to let you know there are a few things which we are missing when we say inclusive policy, or we say tribal welfare, or we say tribal development and other things. I don't know how many of us in this room are tribals, but I'm proud to be called as a tribal. I am from Santhal tribe. So when we talk about inclusive policy, we have to also think about, you know, including them in the discourse as well. And without including them, you know, we are imposing them. They should not be, tribal should not be a kind of beneficiary. It should not be a beneficiary of you know, tribal different schemes or different welfare schemes. So I need to learn a few things, and I need to also give you some you know, bottom-up approach where we belong, and where the speak, where we need to learn from what is coming from the bottom-up approach. Thank you very much.
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Neha Bhaktani. I am from Tata Capital, from the corporate sustainability team. At Tata Capital, we have five different focus areas that we work in, and the first being education, financial literacy, and skill development, where our tribal education project features. Now, this project we've been doing since 2010, where the first initial years were more of learning and infrastructure development for the school at Vikramgarh, which is, I think, about 2.5-3 hours away from Bombay. We've been working with them ever since. We have the school that contributes into the program, as well as 2-3 different partners that work with us. So I'm basically here to share about the project and learn, because what we are looking at to do with the project is the education part as well as skill development, because this features into our Tata Group affirmative action policy and links with our employment and skill development programs as well. So I'm basically here to learn from everybody and see how we can collaborate in the future.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Rachel De Silva. I'm a researcher and teacher with Mumbai University Institute of Distance and Open Learning. I'm basically here to understand tribal issues from my perspective of social sciences and human rights and displaced people, and basically gain from the discussion.
Hi, my name is Subir Ghosh. I am a basically professionally marine biologist, but I have been working in the different arenas of rural development. I started my career as a fishery scientist with Indian Council of Agriculture Research, worked there for 10 years in the Northeast, and then I joined the National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, NABARD. From, well, I worked there for nearly 26 years and retired from service in 2012. So under, while working with NABARD, I have worked on the various aspects of rural development, which has taken me to various states of India including Maharashtra, Odisha, Northeast, and Jharkhand. Jharkhand is one where I had a very good interaction with the tribal populations, and we had extensive work with tribal communities. We worked on Wadi program. I'm sure those who are from Jharkhand will be knowing Wadi program, which is an orchard-based program for the resource poor in areas which are well typically having very scanty rainfall, and then land condition is also not good. So in those areas, we create the basic infrastructure required for taking up dryland farming. And we create, it is an orchard base, so we take long-term gestation crops, their plants. Along with that, we have intercropping with short-duration crops. And on the embankments, we have plants which meet the various requirements, household requirements of the family, tribal family, including firewood, fuel, some medicinal plants, some vegetables of which can come up in dryland areas like drumstick and all. So besides that, we have also worked with the tribals in the watershed development programs and various other value chain involving LAC, involving Tassar. We have worked with Pradhan in then poultry sector. We have women's poultry groups, which we had promoted through Pradhan in Jharkhand. So we had a very extensive programs in Jharkhand, plus similar programs in Maharashtra also we have undertaken, particularly Wadi, which started from Gujarat and it has reached Jharkhand. So in fact, NABARD has been taking it across the country wherever such resource poor areas are there. There we create, first concentration is on the creation of the water resource, minimum water resource which is required to support that orchard-based farming system. And if the first 2 or 3 years you can provide the life-saving irrigation, thereafter you don't have to really bother much about it. That is the consideration. I have also worked with the tribals in northeastern region of the country, where alternate farming to replace the existing method of cultivation of slash and burning, which is called popularly jhooming. On that we have worked. And presently I am working for a UNDP JEF project, which is related to coastal and marine biodiversity conservation in Sindhudurg district. There are two such projects which are being supported by UNDP and JEF in India at the moment on coastal and marine biodiversity. One on the east coast, which is in Godavari and Andhra Pradesh, and the second is in west coast, which is in Sindhudurg. And under this we have various components, which includes conservation of the endangered species. We have corals here, and we have other marine important species which are globally significant, like turtles, like the whale shark, then dolphins, porpoises. We have mangrove conservation is another important area what we are in doing. Apart from this, we have a number of livelihood programs which are climate resilient and which can address the future rise in temperature and its impact from the adaptation point of view. We have envisage that with the rising temperature there will be more pressure on the land-based production system. And the coastal Konkan region on the west coast is very narrow shelf, which is hardly 25 to 40 kilometer. And the existing predominant agricultural activity is paddy. So paddy production will be under
extensive pressure with the sea level rise. So we realized that from lesser area, we'll have to produce more of food grains. So to do that, we have trying to change and bring in a change through introduction of system of rice intensification, which many people here may be aware of system of rice intensification, which is a system where you have only one plant per hill. Supposing this is a hill, in normal practice you have 3 to 4 or even 5 plantlets per hill, which introduces the concept of competition between the plantlets. And it suppresses the productive capacity of the plants. SRI does just that, frees the plants from the competition, allows it to express itself totally. And that is through by putting each plant, one plant, single plant per hill, and allowing a distance of 25 centimeter to 25 centimeter between line and between rows. And this makes it possible to do the weeding also using a weeder. And this weeder, in normal kind of agricultural practice, the weed is removed. Here it is plowed back into the soil, so enriching the soil further. And in the process, aerates the land, soil, and root zone of the plants also gets strengthened. There are many, I should not go in deep into the SRI, but this is a system which has resulted in 40 to 80% higher yield. It has, it has got a tremendous drought coping mechanism because you are using 1/10 the population. So your requirement of seed is 1/10 of the normal kind of cultivation. So thereby, if there is a delay in onset of monsoon, you can go, the farmer can go for a second or a third nursery, staggered nursery. So that's a climate resilient point of view. And thirdly, it also emits 60% less methane than normal kind of paddy grown under water stagnating conditions. Here the water is not kept continuously. The paddy is not under continuous submerges, but alternate wetting and drying. So that kind of a thing. Besides that, we have quite a lot of planning activities cross-sectoral, which we have, which will make it possible to reduce impact of production, various production sectors on the marine life, and that is how it will reduce the pressure on the marine life. Thank you.
My name is Suresh Sahu, and my roots are from a small village in Orissa. I've been out of Orissa for the last 52 years, and 35 of which has been a corporate life. Currently, I pursue my personal life, and the reason I'm here with Kiran and Edubro is to basically find synergies as to how I can provide my services for a better cause. The takeaway from this session is I'd like to look at certain challenges that are related to the tribal issues, and if there is a cause for me to participate and help the tribal people or any of your forums, I'll be more than happy to do that. Thank you.
Hi everyone, this is David from Habitat for Humanity. We have a vision of providing a decent shelter to the poor people. And we have interventions of new houses, repairing houses, and also sanitation, providing sanitation units to the poor. We have our main work in the tribal area, in the rural area. And nowadays we are developing a strategy of how we can help these tribal people for housing plus what else do they require, like livelihood solutions or in anything, how we can help them more. So that I would like to learn today from you guys. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Abha Vijayan. I also work with Habitat for Humanity India. I am manager legal for them. And as David said, we intervene all over India. across tribes, across cross sectors. And as he said, we provide housing, shelter, sanitation, and everything. And right now, we are working on a strategy of impacting 50 villages across all over India for whom we have collected data. And our intervention won't just be limited to housing, but it would cover livelihood, education, sanitation, and all other aspects of their life to help them develop in a very, very positive manner. And we would just, as he said, interested in, you know, gaining what all information we can from here. Thank you so much.
I'm Soma Ghosh. At the moment, I'm not working anywhere. Basically, I've just come here to gain knowledge. And of course, I had done a course on social entrepreneurship, but I have not worked after that. And before that, I was working for Samsung India Electronics for some years, and also with Eureka Forbes. And basically, I've come here to gain knowledge and find out if I could be of any help or any, if I could do any good to any of you. Thank you.
My name is Anmol, and I'm studying journalism here.
So my name is Chetna Asai. I'm doing my post-graduation in journalism and broadcast media at St. Paul's.
Dimension which people spoke about was the education and training area. But what was more heartening was to see that there were a large number of people here that had a lot of common ground in terms of either skills and resources or experiences, and a lot of them have volunteered to participate in cross activities. I'm wondering whether anyone has a very specific requirement which they would like to kick off and say that, you know, we'd like to discuss that and put that kind of a requirement on the table, and we start with that as a point of discussion and take it from there. I feel that might be a way. Does any of you have any a particular project or experience that you want to share which we can use as the starting point for a discussion? Chandrasekhar, you had something specific. Sorry.
I would like to put the issue change of culture and uprooting of tribal people from their own habitat and culture as one of the theme. Because development doesn't necessarily mean that you have infrastructure or some money in your pocket. But it has also to do with your dignity, the place you live in. So whatever we do, whether it is livelihood, whether it is shelter, whether it is education, whether we are trying to uproot these people from their habitat and their cultural traditions, or we are trying to somehow negotiate with these components and trying to find out a middle way ground or way out. So this can be a theme. Then we start with whatever experiences we have with each of the components, say livelihood, education, land issues, and other things.
So the point you've raised is the point that Chandrasekhar, or we'll call him Shekhar for short, has raised earlier, in fact, in off-site discussions. So Shekhar, would you like to kick off? Because he is very, very sensitive, very, you know, keen to discuss this very perspective that you have raised, particularly here. So Shekhar, I leave it to you too.
Hello.
I'm talking more out of my feelings and experiences. From 1973, I was an innocent boy, middle class boy from Hyderabad, thinking that I am educated, I know English, I can develop tribals. And I know law, they don't know law. So if the law is not delivered goods to them, I will help them to get justice in the court. To date, I could not get one justice. In the 40 years, I could not get one justice in the court of law. We could get it in the village. We could get the justice in the village community, not in the court of law. It was very expensive, harassing. Then when I entered, the first 4 or 5 years, I found I don't know their language. I mean, I was always lived in cities. Then going into the village and living, very difficult it was for some years. Once I started in 76, they started supporting me, the villagers. The question of volunteerism, Baba Amte always used to say, live with the people, the ideas come out. Sharing is volunteerism. And we got an idea of education, what was needed, like everyone. I was a boy that time, the boys in the village sitting together. Then we discussed, we have school. Then all the people came together, without money, put a shed. It took 8 months to put a small shed. It took 8 months. But they did it, and they provided food. Now, these kind of activities were building up. From 77, we started getting funds. I do not know even today, I do understand, I'm in a confusion, whether funds are a blessing or otherwise. Because the community, the young people were around me at that time. I was a small hero with them. Every one of us were boys and girls. About 24 of us were there in the team. I was only one non-tribal, all the other tribals. And the team was working out very well. No accounts, no audit, no fighting, no check signature, nothing. We could actually make about, in those years, about 4,000 to 5,000 every month. The actual quantification, if you take, much more than that. So once the money comes, now when I look back, in these 30 years, as voluntary organization we started, with some zeal, marching ideas, their ideas. Now it has become so much professionalized. And interestingly, I see that we have become so much professionalized, and we are also, the work which we are doing as is something like oil in the water, the work. And this danger I realized in the past 20 years, 10 years before. Earlier, all the organizations used to come together. When there was an issue, we had one yatra from Parvatipuram to Polavaram, 300 kilometers, about 240 of us walking, young boys and girls, from about 40 organizations. No emails, even though not the cell phone. Still we could communicate, interact, and plan the details and work. With very less funding, about 20,000 to 30,000 we got for 200 of us, spending about 2 months. We ate in the villages. But the first time I found a jolt, and I realized that we lost the sensitivity with the communities. And also the communities have become alien to themselves with a lot of money, projects. People who were with me, they all got married, they got shipped out. And the younger boys coming. The whole sort of the shift going on. And then I realized something. Then the question, great matter. Because when our friend was talking about culture, because when holistic education, which government is also doing, schools, the other schools also, is it really holistic? How is it they lose their foot on the culture? And with the holistic education, if some, they go for jobs outside and cannot explore possibilities in the village, in their village. And if they cannot feel pride of the tribal, I don't feel the big this. When I feel I'm proud of being with them, but many like they want to get converted into non-tribals. And this is the scene that is prevailing there. And the communities that are working in the village for every social, cultural, and also total local faith festivals. They were not so much for development in those years. In 73, 74, the question of development, the way we saw as education from a perspective of tiled house and all that, was not relevant to them. So there is a real cultural shock or development shock which we see. So what, with this 40 years of experience, this violence between Maoists and the thing just at the border. Because of the violence, about 45,000-50,000 population have come to Andhra Pradesh. And if Godavari comes, Polavaram Dam, our tribals will be displaced. So already those people have come and occupied thousands of hectares of land from Chhattisgarh. And our people start shifting, there will be ethnic clash in Andhra Pradesh. The clash between Gothic Koyas, I mean, these are all things that we are not able to foresee in the future. Then Jabbar, people are now talking of organic food. I saw ads in the week saying that pure wheat and all that. Now we consume naturally Jabbar. Now we don't get it in our area. And that area is being occupied by eucalyptus. So the whole question is in the confusion. What, I mean, some sort of rejuvenation of voluntarism, and can Gram Swaraj be real Swaraj for the economic purposes, control of resources, and can education give that political knowledge of how the Gram Swaraj can be a powerful tool to say even no to what government says? It's just possible. It's an act which gives enough space, enough rights, all the powers to say we don't accept this. Instead of going with the government should come to us. Any development plan, it is the responsibility of government or the corporates to come and talk to the Grama Sabhas, explain them, tell them, tell each Grama Sabha, talk to them. Let them be a positive decision. And if you don't democracy, democracy is more important than development.
The community, that's all it's.
The problem is, I have my personal experience with my wife. Either we need very good toilet, well cleaned, or go out. Not unclean toilets. The tribals won't go there. In a tribal, he feels going to bush is very clean, or a neat toilet, it means good water. Unless water for flushing is provided, it's difficult also in all places. If suppose you have in the cities, the urban centers, people manage to go with a little less clean toilets. But these people need very good toilets. Is that the question? You think why toilets are not succeeding? So in the tribal areas, either you give them very good toilets with water flushing facilities, or something must work out. They cannot just cross to go inside. And the water is an important question there.
So you're saying that basically the problem is the water?
Main, yes. And also the material make.
Gender, and there's the issue of the culture with the scavengers, and I've learned all of this, but I'm trying to understand beyond if there's something that we're missing. Okay, so sir, you're saying that water is a very major obstacle. I've seen some toilets where you do have the water, and still people, you know. I agree, if the toilet is not clean, people don't want to use it. But the question is, why is it not clean? Is it just the absence of water? Maybe there's something else. So, but I don't want to take over the whole conversation. Maybe, you know, there's, if someone else can.
I just want to give one remark from our experiences from Kalinga Institute of Social Sciences. Even we face the similar problem. When a child comes from a tribal village to our institute, we have hundreds of toilets, but we do have a lot of government land behind our institute, and we have two ponds for for teaching pisciculture to the students as a part of vocational studies. So these small toddlers, when they come at the age of 5-6, they don't use the latrine. They go to those government lands and use the pond water and come back. So we have instituted something called life skill education, in which they are taught, it's part of the curriculum as well. They're taught how to, for example, how to wash their hands, how to use the toilets, how to look after their health and hygiene. So this life skill education, and of course, later on, one more component is added to it. It's called the adolescent reproductive and sexual health. That I'll talk to later. But this life skill education is basically helping us a lot in terms of addressing this issue.
Habitat is in building sanitation units in some years now, and as we have studied, people have the sanitation unit, but if you go to Punjab, people take Mercedes and they go for open defecation. This situation is there, and it's in ancient times, this thought has been there that every clean thing is supposed to be done in house, and unclean things are to be kept outside of the house. So this defecation and all, they want to keep it outside of the house. That's why even if today you want to build a sanitation unit, they won't build it inside the house. They will build outside the house. Okay, we believe in the things that as we build a sanitation unit, we call it as hardware part, the construction part. It is only 50%. The main thing is hardware part. Their heart needs to be changed, and that is 50%. So only building sanitation units. Of course, we are just building a storage place for them. And we need to do a behavior change communication thing, like sir said, a life skill things and all. And it's a process. It won't happen in 1 year or so. It will take some years. So NGOs need to teach people, and after some years, maybe we'll see that impact. Thanks.
I fully agree with, endorse what my friend from Habitat just now mentioned. But I will quote an example of a place where it has been successful. And probably you'll be able to draw the inferences, and that will also support whatever he said. There's a place called Vengurla, which is on the southernmost district of Maharashtra, along the coast, if you go. And the Vengurla municipality has done a wonderful work on both open defecation, on solid waste management, and disposal of untreated sewage into the sea. And that's a popular tourist spot also. The municipality, the work which they have done on the open defecation front is, firstly, they have created hardwares. They have created the facilities along the place where people can go and use the facilities. Secondly, they have launched several awareness campaigns and talked to people. Then they have come out with a sort of legislation banning open defecation, and they have created a good morning squad which goes around the favorite spot. Yeah, and that's working wonderfully, and it has brought out the desired result. Inferences you can draw.
It's a wonderful example. One point I would like to add here. There is a tribe called Ho, H-O-Ho. Ho tribe is the one. There are multiple of tribes, which they worship their ancestor in their home inside. like in the interior of their house, they do all the rituals, like they recall them during the festival, during any day of happiness, day of sorrow, they recall them by putting rice beer in the, you know, in the floor, or by doing some rituals out there in the interior of the house. And whole tribe, you know, they bury their, you know, dear ones inside the house. So it's very unacceptable to the tribals to build a, you know, bathroom or build a latrine in the house, and, you know, it's unacceptable to them. So instead of using them, they keep it as a, you know, storage purpose.
I fully agree with my friend. Actually, I'm just put it in a theoretical level. In Hindu society, everything, one of the sociologists called Louis Dumo, he has extensively studied Hindu religion, and he came to the conclusion that Hindu religion is based on binary of purity and pollution. What he was telling, that you cannot have a latrine inside the house. So some, like, going to the toilet is impure, and everything inside the house is pure. And even if you see in villages, when the people go to defecate, they change their clothes. And when they come inside, I mean, outside, they just throw the clothes and wear another cloth and come inside. So it has a lot to do with the religion also, the way of life, the purity pollution concept, that defecation is impure, pure is being clean and inside the house. Dalits are impure, pure is a Brahmin. Dalits cannot enter temple because they are impure. So this purity pollution concept is might be the base of for Hindu religion, at least.
I think it is across the religion, across the past, the feeling is common. It is that I cannot impure my house by building a thing, but I can create that same amount of dirt and filth around my community. So I don't have any ownership on the outside. That's a new point, how we look at it. If that is what needs to be changed, then probably what you say is creating awareness has a role in that.
So one more point, like, they also see it as a fertilizer kind of thing. They see, like, open defecation also fertilize the land out there. So we cannot, escape from the point. We need to see the population, and we need to see the population approach itself.
But I will say that the crop grown out from that field, they will not touch. They may sell.
I don't know, but also they see it as a fertilizer. I don't know.
Okay. Yeah, I think now, just to end this up, I must tell you, recently I met someone who said, in the olden days, we ate at home and defecated outside. Nowadays, we eat outside and defecate at home. So I thought that that was quite a telling cultural change. Now, coming back to the issue, Chandrasekhar, you raised this issue about how you would like to see the respect within the community and the individuals take it up, and when you spoke about external interventions. I'd like to ask Neha, when you went to your village to take up the project about education and the projects that you took up, what drove your motive and your intention? So at the broader level, you said you wanted to make an intention to make a difference to the life of tribals. But the choice of the intervention in that community, was it driven because there was an internal or an expressed need from that community that this is our need, and you stepped up to respond to their need and the way they would prefer to have that education done? Or is it because Pratham has a model which they've tried and tested, and you think that that's a model to implement? And the reason why I'm raising this, because in Mendeleka, they shared with us that they have a system called the Gotul system, which I guess may be common, but I'm not knowledgeable enough. And that Gotul system of learning that the people went through, they found it was extremely good, sustainable, and retained their culture, practices, etc. Now their kids have to go to a Marathi medium school. they feel that it's taking away from their culture. So in that context and in the expectation of Shekhar, I was wondering if you could respond with a Tata cap perspective, since you are now going there with no other reason. You weren't looking at them as your potential client. So you went there with a perspective of contributing to that community. If you can just share with us, what was it that took you there?
Okay, so I'll give a bit of a context first of how we actually started the project. Our intervention with this particular area, it's in Vikramgarh, which is the tribal belt in Maharashtra. Okay, it started only because one, we wanted to follow the guideline from the Tata Group, which is the affirmative action policy that looks at scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. And in 2010, we had a very meager CSR budget. We actually did not have any budget at that time. So we started with a very, very small intervention. This school was suggested by one of our NGO partners whom we had already been working with. We went, we visited the school. So our entry point to the community was the school. So we started only working with the school for about 4-5 years because we had a very, very little budget and we could only make very small changes in the beginning. The school operated out of just one shed. There was no other facility. Okay, it's a residential, it's an ashram shala for the tribal children. We started off with a science lab, okay, because that was something that they wanted for their 8th standard students, and we did that as the first intervention with the school. After that, we built a library for them. After that, we started working on a plan so that we could they could have a proper school. Since they were only operating out of one shed, they couldn't really expand and get all the other children to enroll in the school. So right now, the school has about 2 levels, a separate section for the girls and separate section for the boys to stay, separate toilets for them. There are about 350 students who stay there in the school, and about 559 students who attend the school. So the other students come from nearby communities. Initially, as I told you, we only looked at infrastructure. So the building, community hall, the school didn't even have a compound. They had a well, but there were no walls to the well. So we kind of did all of those things. And now that we have good enough budget in CSR, only in the past 2 years, we've started working with Pratham. Now, this school is a Marathi medium school that is run as per the tribal education in Maharashtra. And their Marathi dialect is also very different from what we speak in Bombay or in Pune, right? So we brought in Pratham to kind of help them develop their conversational skills as well as kind of teach them the English program, their Read India program and the Read India Plus program. So they have 2 separate programs for the primary students and for the secondary students now. Along with this particular school, we also wanted to tap into the other schools which are in Vikramgarh. Okay, there are I think about 45 different schools there where Pratham runs this Read India Plus initiative, so that there is some form of understanding of English in case if these children in the future want to go out of their community, they get some platform of opportunity and they do want to converse with other communities outside, there has to be at least a single platform for conversation. So we introduced the English program that has been running successfully for the past 2 years. Pratham did not have any presence there earlier, but this was their first step where we started with the school and then we went into the community. So the principal of the school actually helped us to tap into the community and gain their support also. Along with Pratham, in the last year only, we've brought in Magic Bus. Magic Bus helps them for personality development and sports development. Now, the tribal population obviously is very close to their sports culture as well. Here in Maharashtra, they're very close to Khoko and Kabaddi. So from these particular communities, we are working with them, developing the youth leaders from their own communities so that they can tap into the children. These children come to the school and for these sports development sessions. And currently, we have about five in each sport, which will get trained for state and national level competitions. So these are very small steps that we've taken over the past 6 years. What we see our program doing is we do want to build into skills development, because after the 10th, there is really no way to keep in touch with these children. So we are working to develop this system. Maybe have the teachers in the school are actually helping us to get in touch with the with about 300 students who've passed out of that particular school in the past 3 years, to know what do they want to do, what they are doing right now, where are they, and what kind of skills they are looking at, keeping in mind that they might not want to move from their particular community or their particular area of residence. So that survey will be done this year, and basis that, then we are going to design on what kind of platforms or opportunities we need to bring into these kids. Because until and unless we know what they really want, we can't develop or design our own project or get the expertise from outside. So so I completely agree with sir that we are an outside community for them. For us to build trust with that community, to understand what they need, and for them to build trust in us so that we can give that opportunity is very important. Before we just go up to them and say that, boss, this is our agenda, do you agree or do you not agree? So I don't think that's the right approach. So right now what we are working on is the survey that I spoke about. And we also want to bring in a more, a little bit of more processes into the schools. Because once these kids start learning English, I think they would also want to know what are the opportunities from outside that the schools can help them provide, or the interactions that they would probably need. So I'm open to hear any feedback on that.
In relation to that, Jasab, you were heading the training and research wing of the tribal unit in Maharashtra. I saw in your profile that you've been participating and leading a lot of the research activities in terms of the tribal needs and what are the trainings that are appropriate for the tribals, not only in terms of livelihoods, but also in relation to the Forest Act. And the Forest Act, which basically governs their very existence, where they are in their location. Maybe if you could share with us your perspectives, not on just their needs, but on the pedagogy, and how was it effective to train such people, and what were the mechanisms that you used? And why I think that's important for me and probably some of the others here is to understand in relation to KISS, the Kalinga Institute has been highlighting that they have 25,000 tribal units, students in their hostel. And to me, that raises a very important question to understand, that what is the merits or the challenges and demerits in moving these 25,000 tribal students away from their habitat to an external offshore base for their learning, vis-a-vis taking the learning and the training into their habitat and training them there. So maybe from your research, and then maybe KISS can share what are the reasons why they've opted for this mass training in a particular location vis-a-vis going into the community and letting that training be community centered.
Actually, before I speak on the issue that you have talked about, I would like to compliment his viewpoint, but additionally, would like to say that from the tribal point of view, something which I require should be provided to us by whoever is the provider. It may be an NGO, it may be a government, it may be any other CSR, whatever. That is the first point, of course, which I don't think anybody would disagree with. But one thing, being in the government, I have felt that ultimately government's presence cannot be actually overlooked. You cannot deny government's presence. Because there are so many schemes, so many programs, they have entered into every part of your life. That whether it is your community, whether it is is and if he passes, you make him the king. So that time it was olden times, so he was sent to a jungle. There was a rishi. Rishi is. You know rishi?
Sage.
So he was sent to a sage for learning. That sage started. The first task was. Fruits and flowers, etc., etc., for my worship. So he went there. After 3-4 days, he again said, "This is not the job of a king. So please give me a certificate or let me go." He said, "You can go. You can't get a certificate." He said, "Give me a better work." He said, "Yes, last work I'm going to give you. You have to go to the jungle and hear whatever you, whatever noises or whatever animals' voices sounds." First day he came back, he said, "I heard a lion roar today." Next day he went, he said, "I heard an elephant trumpet today," etc., etc. In 10-15 days he came back and he said that, "I have heard everything and I have narrated everything to you. Now my certificate." So the king said, "No, no." The sage said, "No, this is not really a pass. So it's that you have not heard so many things that are there in the forest." And then this boy, said, "Okay, I don't require your certificate." He started going away, going to his father. On way, he thought that if I go to my father, I won't become the king. So why don't I spend some time in the forest itself? He sat in a tree. And after
the lesson for the government, that is the lesson for those, and perhaps each one of us who are thinking what tribal needs. And therefore, there has to be complementing your efforts to raise the children that you are raising, sir, in your village, with all kinds of skills and knowledge and strengths. There has to be a complementary effort through the civil society reaching the government as to what they need, and that has to be taken together. That is my suggestion to this August gathering. As regards trainings, I must tell you, the tribals are perhaps most intelligent people, most honest, most creative. You wouldn't believe that when we were implementing the Forest Rights Act, we started giving GPS to the Forest Department people for measuring the lands of the tribals. And some of the NGOs, they were against it. They said, no, Forest Department, they will never do justice to the tribals. Therefore, don't give GPS instruments to the Forest Department. I was the commissioner, but I was also a forester. So I said, okay, I'll train anybody and everybody on GPS to handle it. And you won't believe, we trained 1 lakh. That yes, we must go and talk to them equal at equal level, understand what their needs are, and their skills, their professional needs, they all come forth very easily. Of course, breaking the ice is required. It takes time because of partly we have also treated them differently, and partly because the tribals also have been taught that they are being treated differently because of some kinds of policy. So it takes some time, but once you break the ice, they are the best people to work. I think collaborative way of finding out what the best skill sets they require, what is the best knowledge set is required for that particular area, especially connecting the natural resources with their livelihoods. That is one very basic thing that one must appreciate and go into, because example is, on the sea coast, most of the economy for the local people is fishing. And the tribals don't have anything other than the minor forest products, small forest products. So one must endeavor to connect these resources with them and develop the skill sets that are required to manage these aspects. And that is what we did in tribal department also when I was there. We did research on the relationship between minor forest produce and the tribe livelihoods. We have had large number of films made. We have about 71 films on various issues, right from livelihood to cultural issues of the tribals, which are in the archives of the Pune Tribal Research Training Institute. And research reports are there. So that is how I think we have to go about it. The only thing is, we should have willing people to work honestly, transparent way, and we should have people who can fund these things, including the government. And government, obviously, we have to properly teach them how to deal with the issue and how to deal with the problems. I have been a part of the government, and that's why I can be very forthright and honest when I speak all this. Thank you.
Tushar or Kadei, would you like to share your thoughts? Sorry, you have also something to say? Yeah, one second.
Yeah, sure. Okay, so basically I was like during my college years, I was working with a like a slum area. I was working with slum area. So I'm like just comparing it. I just want a basic rough idea that what should be the solution for that problem, which I heard there. Like I heard people saying here that the sir said that we should not take them away from their culture, and we should not, like, if you want to train, there are two things. First of all, if we want development, we want their thoughts to be changed, right? But we also consider that there are people surrounding them who pushes them down. Like they are not encouraged by the people surrounding them. Like example, if somebody is drinking alcohol there, if we teach one person that no, please don't consume alcohol, then there'll be 10 more people who will be taking alcohol in front of him. So he'll gradually, maybe for after 10 days, 15 days, he'll also join them. And so the drawback is, like, he will do whatever his community is doing. And on the other hand, if we take that person away from the community for the development purpose, we are snatching his right to be in, to be within the community. So what can be the solution? Like, should we focus on development by keeping that person away from the community, or should we, like, focus on their development by keeping him inside within the community, and how that problem can be solved? That is my question.
I think you've raised two issues that I sense. One is the definition of development. So when you say that we are developing them, whose perspective of development are we discussing? And when we take them away for development, or we keep them there for development, so maybe both Tushar and Cody have researched this area. Share with us this perspective of the donors or the interventionist perspective of development vis-a-vis what the local community perceives as their development, and what's their right to their perspective of development with the resources that may come from the outside with a very different perspective. But yet, it's their perspective, and do we and can we, without any strings attached, support them in their perspective is one aspect. And maybe also touch on the earlier issue, which again, what's your name? Abba raised about moving them away from their habitat and keeping them in their habitat to support their learning.
Both the culture and the habitat.
Yeah.
It's basically a fundamental question. It's more an academic question than a question which has practical nuances. Although it has some practical nuances, I'll come to it. Academically speaking, when we talk about development of tribals, there were many theories when, after independence, how to go about the development of the tribals, whether it has to be assimilation or segregating them and developing them in isolation, as we have reservations in America. Likewise, I mean, there were Elvin theory and a lot of things were there. How to go about it, whether to completely assimilate tribals to the general population or to have their own culture, and then you develop with whatever schemes that you have. Coming to the context of KISS, our organization, what we generally do is we have a middle ground, because we strongly feel that we also need to take the practicalities of life into account. For example, I won't send my children to an Odia medium school. I'll send my children to an English medium school. Like a tribal person, I'll also, if I send my son to an English medium school, he also loses his culture. He loses his language. He's more westernized than what I am. Personally, I believe that you have to be modernized rather than westernized. But things happen that way. For a tribal, similar logic happens. For a tribal child, our organization is in Bhubaneswar. What we have thought of is, when a tribal child comes to Bhubaneswar, now we have uprooted them from their community. Now what we have done is, he comes to the city. Now what happens generally there is, we have developed ourselves in such a way that we see the needs of the tribal children. So, as you told, culture and language is one of the component which we have to look after. So what we have done is, there are two ways we have dealt with it. One is we have started a program called Mother Tongue Based Multilingual Education. That is nothing, basically the initial few months, the children will study in their own mother tongue. That's why we have recruited a lot of tribal teachers. So a lot of tribal teachers are there in our institute who bring this cultural and language sensitivity into the classroom. So the tribal children doesn't feel alien from its culture, neither from the person who teaches him or her. Now from that tribal language and the dialect, he now transits to the language of the formal instruction, that is the Odia. We are affiliated to the Odia state medium school as curriculum. So that is how we deal with them. Along with that, somebody when he grows up, for that matter, because most of the times he is there in the school and he doesn't go to the villages to observe festivals and all, we observe festivals, tribal festivals, Maghe Parab, lot of festivals that we observe in kids. So what I'm trying to tell is that the world is going in one way. It's going towards globalization. Now you have to be a communist or you have to be a Tina factor. There is no alternative. So if there is no alternative, then you have to find a middle way out. And that is what we are trying hard to do that. And of course, as sir was telling, we are also opening our schools in different headquarters, district headquarters, so that the local students from various adjoining villages can come and study there. So we are in the process of opening a lot of schools in those tribal populated districts. And there is a reason for why we insist on boarding schools. If you see the tribals in Odisha, they don't stay in hamlets. If two houses are here, after 500 meters or 1 kilometer, you'll find two houses. How do you build one school in between those houses, or how do you cater to the need of a scattered population which stays in scattered houses? So that's why we strongly believe that one of the solution of giving tribal education is to have boarding schools. Of course, the government is also doing Ekalavya and other, a lot of other schools for girls are also opening up. So this is the middle way out which we have practically thought of.
Kadi, do you want to add?
Yeah. In our institute, it's not us who decide. We have a committee, like we have a parents committee, we have a district administration, and they mobilize villagers. And we have like, if you have BPL, and if you have caste certificate, then only you can go and try your chance to get into that institute. Few of our teachers, they go and facilitate that process in a different districts. Suppose, not even a district, in a small blocks of a particular district. So it's not that we are the final decision maker and no, I'll take your kid and I'll not take your kid. It's not that we decide. We have some small counseling session and take it to the district administration and the parents committee, we call it as a parents committee, they decide and they facilitate all the process. Two of our teachers, they do all the documentation and the dates will be there. Okay, you have to bring this kid to the campus with a small bag or something, and we provide everything. That is one. Second one, I'm just forgetting the second one, is there are 9,000 students so far graduated from that institute. And out of that 6,000 students, they have went back to their villages and they're working as a revenue inspector, they're working as a in a post office, or they're working in a forest department, or they're working somewhere or other, they're working some in civil society as well. So that is one aspect. I remember the other aspect. We have heard a lot of aspect of child labor. We have heard a lot of affected Naxals areas are there. So we have heard from the parents of the children, lot of parents, they say, if my children could have not been in KIS, he could have been in some or the other groups in the extremist, you know, group. So we are not only, you know, development and you know, displacement cannot go hand in hand, but in other way we can say, we are not doing either of these. We are, you know, we are putting them and we are saying, okay, we are empowering you and you decide, you know, what you are going to do and what you are expected to do. That is what, thank you very much.
Sai, in your experience, Sai, by the way, is a researcher and spent 45 days in Chatti village documenting and experiencing what was going on there. And one of the purposes of that experiment was to identify what were the opportunities for young interns who may want to go and spend time in a tribal village, and so that there would be a good fit between the interns' skills and abilities on the one hand and their needs and the village needs. And what were the priorities and how could the village then create a resource base locally so that the whole process of the intern going to that village was successful, in inverted commas. That means they both met their needs. You mentioned one of the things earlier, Sai, when we met offline, was that in terms of the livelihoods and in terms of what the villagers, the youth did, their aspirations to move away from the village on the one hand, to look at a different lifestyle, and the fact that there was no value addition from the minor forest produce. So they either chopped the bamboos and sold it off, or they plucked the tendu leaves and they sold it off, but there was no value addition in between. So in terms of the skill development, and in terms of them adding value locally, what were your perspectives there in terms of the youth's aspiration and their perception towards this?
One of the striking features that you get to see when you visit a remote area, or for that matter any place, even in a city like Bombay, you will see that nothing is simplistic. Like when I say that individuals are here and they come with certain aspirations, that aspiration itself could be multiple. I mean, it is not something which is common for everyone. So even in Chatti village, there are people, young people, who, especially because if you see over the years, literacy has gone up, and you have a lot of graduates there. I mean, again, like Malini said, you can dispute the standards, whether they've been met or not, but then yes, they are graduates, BSc, et cetera, et cetera. But then again, when you actually look into it, are they actually employable? Because a lot of them have gone to neighboring towns like Rajahmundry, Khammam, and other such urban areas around that village. Some of them, or probably a large chunk of them, have returned back. And that's where the whole question comes into that, whether education has actually helped them or kind of ruined their livelihood or, for that matter, employment factor as a whole. Also, the other thing is that, like you mentioned, about the minor produce that they have and the utilization of that, which is done in a very traditional manner. But we have come across areas or avenues where this could be furthered into making it more productive. Produce that is largely available is a mawa tree there, which is they called as ippu tree, ippu in the Koya in Telugu, ippa tree. So that tree can be utilized for not in the sense of industrial scale, but then at least on a SME, that is small and medium sized enterprise, can be used and can be used as a very sustainable model, which could also provide them employment in the area itself, instead of them moving to urban areas where they are not accepted or fully accepted. So when I talk about Mahua tree, that is one example. There is one another common tree that is found across the area is toddy palm or Palmyra palm that is called. You have so many items that can be produced by these two trees, which are very which are in abundance in this area, but it is not being done currently. Not that there are no organizations there. There are organizations which do have done some kind of work in this area, especially in the in terms of research in case of Mahua, and where the Mahua flower itself or the Mahua produce itself has been made it into consumables, and these consumables can actually be deterrent to malnutrition. So it's not only livelihood, but even health factor and a lot of things, nutrients, nutrient value, and all of these can actually help the locals in terms of, as I said, health, even livelihood. If you just have some kind of SMEs established in this area, not that they have not been established, but they are not being kind of sustainable or maybe not feasible enough as of now. I mean, as per my study, I could be wrong. What I think can be done here is that probably because the youth is very interested towards tertiary sector, or for that matter, jobs in the sense of very, day job, where you get paid they are not interested in wage anymore. So they need a monthly salary, which could be a fixed one or based on the incentives that they can get added. So if these SMEs can be established in this area, and based on these two main produce, but can other such produce can also be utilized. And these can be the youth who have some knowledge about the produce, can be employees, and they will get fixed allowances or salaries. This can actually be a feasible exercise, and probably can also be an example of sustainability. So that is one of the key aspects that I took away from that area. There are other things that are also important to note. Is that, okay, the one thing that I forgot to say is that you, when I say the youth are interested in these kind of service-related jobs, there is a sizable population who are content being in this area. So that's why I go back to the point that I made initially, that there is no simplistic or one way or a common answer to any question that you can raise, or for that matter, any questions that has been raised in this forum until now. So that's why I say that, you know, it's very complicated, but some of the things that I notice, I share it. Before I wrap up, someone raised a point about sanitation, and we have a very traditional answer to that, saying that latrines are generally are not part of the house or the homes, and they are kept at a distance, but that is no longer the case. I mean, of course, it is still practiced. It is still there in Shekhar's house. I've seen it. So, but then largely that practice is waning. So, with that practice that is waning over a period of time, has sanitation improved simultaneously? It's not. So when I see people saying that that is a reason why we are having that. Our sanitation habit is not hygienic enough, and connect that to our kind of old practices of toilets being away from our homes, I don't find that satisfactory enough. So that was a comment that I want to make back then, but as a part of this, I did. Thank you.
There are at least three or four resource centers here. Said, we need help. There is Shekhar, who's presented a perspective saying that, you know, the
we like it to be our way, and yet we need the source here. You have Malini here who said, we have a need for youth training, development, and resource building back there. Now, an organization like yours, Neha, may have geographic specificities in what you are doing, it's possible.
Yes.
Others may not. Nawal may have schemes elsewhere, and having to have maybe taken projects elsewhere. ADKIS, are you not sure if you're doing outreach programs outside of Orissa? And are you looking at collaborative working with people outside of Orissa? So maybe in relation to both Shekhar's earlier opening and Malini's sharing, maybe can you share with what are the possibilities of collaboration and assistance for resource inputs that can go to them? Suresh, you're an independent person in management, in training, in resource development, by profession and experience. If there's anything that you can share, you volunteer to assist. So we give the last few.
With regards to partnerships, yes, of course, proximity to our offices, to our areas of operation is a constraint. But then again, we are looking to expand our own tribal outreach and the projects, and we'll be more than happy to hear what kind of help each one of us would require and see what is feasible, depending obviously on our budget constraints, what we can bring to the table. Like I said earlier, one of the project phases that we are currently working on is on the skill development part. And with the discussion on the aspirations of the youth, you mentioned that there are about 9,000 students who've already passed out from KISS, and 6,000 have gone back to the villages. Can you throw some light on what happened to the 3,000 other and what they are doing right now?
Basically, most of, I don't know it's about everyone or it's about the tribal children. They want to become teacher, and that too, government teacher, primary or secondary level. And they want to go to the government sector job. So they prepare, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, and then the competition is so high, they don't get through. So we say, you start with this, and you prepare for the other one, and if you are getting that, you can go ahead. I would like to, Shekhar said one example. I would like to add one example. There are, TCS is running one free employability training program for our kid. And it's also running for the, state of Orissa. So 7 of our children, they got selected in TCS. And it's not non-voice, job. They'll be holding the entry point executive or something. I don't know the position. So we were very happy, and somebody, it was in the initial years, somewhere in 2010 or 9. So we were very happy. We brought them shoes, clothes, because some of them, they don't have formal clothes and all. And we hired a place in Kolkata for 2 months. We paid for that, and we took them. And finally, they are very, they didn't like it. Because the culture is different. It's all corporate setup. People are saying hi, and the language, they know English, but it's not so fluent English so that they can speak up. So I don't know if I answered your question or not, but most of them, they want to become teacher, and they want to go back to the village, and some of them, they want to work with the PSU, public sector unit. It's a very stable job and a lot of welfare scheme and a lot of employees, security is there. So that is what they are looking for. And we also invite our postgraduate student, those who have done their state level or BEd degree or diploma, we invite them as a teacher. They can come and they can sit in the process, but it's not that rigid for them. We don't put written exam and all. But for everyone, you know, we put them in interview and which language you want to, you know, teach or something. We invite like almost 100 or 200 every year, but only 100 join, you know, those who are in their own respective villages. We call them and it's like, okay, if you would like to join as a teacher in our institute, we can you know, help you and you can get some financial assistance as well. And you know, next is we are very open for the collaboration or any partnership or any mutual benefit for each and every organization, each and every individual. We invite you to come and visit. If at all you are in Bhubaneswar, you come to our institute, and if you want to, you know, see, because most of the people in Orissa, there's like 25,000. I was also in Bhubaneswar. I was also not believing that. A couple of years back, it was, sometime it was in 15,000. I said, 15,000 in Bhubaneswar? There is no such place. But seeing is believing, and we are working from last 3 years, I'm working with them. So yes, we are very open, and we can assist, and we can also, you know, share some help. We can send some of our, you know, we have MSW as a course, BSW as a course in postgraduate and graduate simultaneously. Then we can send our student so that they can get also the exposure and also, you know, a different perspective of, you know, learning. And your organization and ma'am organization, we are also willing to send, you know, because it's a mutual learning kind of thing for them as well and for you also. Suppose out of 10 student or out of 15 or 20 student, if some of them, they feel like joining you and, you know, helping you in the whole struggle and whole, you know, the work you are doing. So that we can, you know, collaborate and we can talk in detail. Yes, sir.
It is Odisha, na?
Yes.
So you have people speaking Khoya language?
Yes, yes.
In your area. Because what we will be interested is if some postgraduates, I mean MSWs, can spend a couple of months with us, Khoyas. It will be a fantastic contribution. And we just want their travel to come to our place. We will give them food, they can stay with us. I mean, talk to the people. Give me about 3-4 people. Is there? Kon?
Yes, yes.
No. No, no, the one thing, let's say, like Guttipaya, Muria, Guttikoya. And some, this, now like in Manda, you have again Koya, Kons.
Yes, yes.
The language little differ.
Yes, yes.
Now, where, what I'm requesting is, now, at this point of time, I would like to have others also. In Malkangiri and Motu area, you have Koyas.
Yes.
They speak very similar to us. In fact, we are same. Humid states. We are same. Huh? That side and this side and this side. So what I want is the same Khoyas I want. Are they there? I mean, I'm talking of immediate need. The subsequent need, the mutation changes we can handle. That's my point.
We'll share the details.
Malkangiri, that area, Khoya, will be great.
Once I go back tomorrow.
Yes. So we'll give exchange our cards. You have cards, something like that?
Yes, sir.
You have some address of yours?
Yes, yes, I have.
Yes, yes, we'll take. And you also, I think we'll do it. But this will be a good beginning. Because paisa logo aane se paisa
phir aayega. You know, they love to be with you. They
sure.
Learn so many things
from
you. Don't No. I'll go, I'll be going tomorrow. Then I'll be working on that. And then I'll give you a call or we'll be in touch with the phone or email. Thank you.
I'll be here.
So, Shubir, what's your first name?
Eugene.
David, can you all comment on possible collaboration, assistance, whether your projects can, cannot work, any of your learnings that can be shared with Malini and
of course, what you want to play.
Yeah. Okay, it's very interesting to see each of the tribal pockets have different needs. As someone said, you have to adapt to the needs of each particular pocket. Where we work is in the interiors of RA Colony, which is in Mumbai. And there are tribal pockets within Mumbai, which not many people are aware of. It's about 27 such hamlets are within about 3,000 square meters in the jungles of Borivali to Goregaon. So what we've identified over there is we identify the skills of what they possess. The women are not allowed to go out and work. So we identified the skills, what they have was cooking. And that's how we started off, by letting them cook a typical tribal meal and inviting people from Mumbai and surrounding cities to come and have a meal in a typical tribal setting, and also seeing the vegetation, the farming that is being done by them. So parallelly, we have also been looking at sustained farming initiatives, basic things like mulching and which they already know, so something which we have learned from them, and whatever organic produce that they have been growing comes directly onto the lunch. So it can't get better than that. And whilst we have been doing, we have also fortunate to set up the only library in the whole of RA colony. There's only one library which is in unit 22. There are 32 units within the whole of RA colony. So not all of them are able to reach that library, but at least the surrounding 3 to 5 units are utilizing that library. And we are intending to reach to the other units as well and look at livelihood mechanisms in place for each of those tribal families without them going out to look out for jobs. So that's what we have been trying to achieve. Having said that, you'll be surprised to note, it probably has come in the newspapers as well, there's only one school in the whole of, there's a BMC school which is not having electricity for the past 5 months. Can you believe that? And we are in Mumbai. And the children are from the month of April. They are actually studying, they're just going to the school, and there's been dropouts. So there's been a fight between Reliance, PWD, and the Forest Department. It's because only of the bureaucracy. There should be government people sitting down in this forum and trying to see, what difficulties the Adivasis and the tribal people go through. If there is a way, mechanism or a way where this could be reached to them, that's something would really solve the problem. And it's very sad to know the children has to go through that. Tomorrow we have to, after this forum, we'll be rushing to Dadar BMC just to sort out the issue of getting an electricity for the school. So basic necessities are not even present. I can imagine what difficulties what you must be going through. Sir, hats off to what work that you all have been doing when we have been facing so much of problems within Mumbai. So if there is, and I'm sure, you've set up a university, I will definitely keep that in mind. I've got your brochure as well. It's something where maybe our tribal children, if we could speak to them and see whether they could take up some sort of learnings from your institute and see whether what could be brought back into the community. There were two gentlemen over here. I was wanting to talk to them. I've of course taken their cards. In terms of how the tribals are not to be displaced, as we speak right now, the government is trying to displace them from their land and putting them into buildings. Now, what are they going to do into buildings? What the source of livelihood is farming. They only know farming. What will they do after being put into buildings? So that's something which I really need to connect with them and see whether we could do anything about it. But these are some of the difficulties, and of course it's a good forum for us to really see, to connect and see whether which are the areas where we could collaborate, perhaps even with you, Neha, and see whether we could, if there is some sort of a mechanism where we could try and network. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to comment on the community participation which we discussed. I have two good examples of that. In one of the village in Usmanabad, there was a youth group of 18 years, 20 years, and they just got inspired that they want to create a model village. Okay, and I think they used to discuss among them that our village needs to be developed more and all, and somehow they got in touch with us, and there were only 25 sanitation units in that village that time. And in a year, they also participated well, and we could make that village 100% with sanitation units. And also they did the villagers participated in river deepening projects, and also they built a school. So I think such movements, you know, those needs to be created somehow. It can be our encouragement, or it can be something. And I have other example in Karjat, where one village was full of drunkards. Okay, there was no man used to work on field or something like that. And at that time, women of those that village, they took initiative, and they used to sit together, and they used to dream that we need to have a nice village. And when they used to have a meetings and all, their drunk husbands, they used to come and beat them, and just they used to take them home saying that I'm hungry, make food for me and all. But you know, and that time there was zero pakka house, okay, permanent house in that village. But women kept on gathering and discussing. So NGOs like us, okay, they helped them that time. And today, all women, they drive that village, you know, they run that village, and they do not need any man, okay. And there are 100% houses built in that village. So I think how these movement can be created, we need to see, okay. And of course, people like us, you know, we can inspire them, and we just need to provide a helping hand, and people can just progress and develop, okay. And if they if that movement comes, I would again, for the habitats approach, I would like to say that of course we want to collaborate, network. Habitat has expertise in housing, and we would like to collaborate with NGOs who have expertise in livelihoods, water harvesting, and any other aspect of life which is needed. And how can together we can work together, and maybe we can work for a model village, something like that. We can create a model, and we can have some plan, 3 to 5 years plan, and we can work together with a proper focus. Thank you so much.
So as I have told that I'm from Children Toy Foundation, we are into like developing libraries which have games and toys. Similar, this concept is similar to the book library, right? So today, like, we are a small NGO, like working basically in Mumbai only, but we have 314 libraries set up all over India. And now we wish that we should have a library in each and every state and district and union territories of India. So basically, we are working on it. And also, along with, like, this don't only, you know, emphasizes, this don't only educate children through toys and games. They also, like, see, if we are installing library in particular area, we also send our volunteers to them for a month to train the people around that to manage the libraries. So this also engage, this also improve the what we say employment opportunities for in the area surrounding that. So I am here to like if anybody can like we can collaborate so that we can discuss about the opportunities for the same. Thank you.
Limitation to collaborations. We had a collaboration with Tata Steel, Jamshedpur. Tata is sponsoring us with a big library, but we have one library for the mother tongue based multilingual education thing. But of course, for a different perspective, we would like to get associated with it. We were interested.
I don't know if I had missed upon this point when I was out. You know, I heard everyone saying that it is very essential for to ensure that their culture, their way of living remains intact. I would not disagree to it, but I would like to know if there are any initiatives to, you know, expose them to mainstream languages. Because I believe language becomes a major barrier when it comes to communication with them. So any initiatives to ensure they also learn Hindi or English or, you know, whichever is the mainstream language in their particular state. Because it's also important for them, you know, for inclusive growth, I would rather. So, are there any initiatives of those sort?
Talking about,
like anyone,
okay,
anyone.
You can, to start with, our organization, what we have done, you're talking about, as a part of curriculum, we have Hindi, English, Odia as the subjects. But the medium of instruction is Odia, basically. When you teach mathematics, you use Odia. You cannot use Odia for English, of course. But then the stress is mostly on the vernacular medium. So what, in order to address their English skills, basically to equip them to go to US or somewhere else, some foreign universities or colleges, community colleges in US. So what we have done is we have collaborated with US Department of State, and US Department of State through US Embassy runs a program called English Access Micro Scholarship Program, which is basically to impart English reading, speaking, listening, and four skills, skills to these children. So it is not basically a soft skill thing, speaking fluent English, this is not the basic aim. It is basically to deal with all the components, reading, speaking, writing and reading skills. And besides that, there are also other components, like a tribal child doesn't know what a station is, what an airport is, what a post office is, what a hospital is. So what we do is, as a part of enhancement activity, we give them exposure to all these places, use those vocabularies and all. So this is one part. Our students are going to US since 3 years repeatedly. For different cultural immersion programs and different programs from this project. So we are working on it.
You still have an institute, so I absolutely understand there could be more formalized way of...
I'm telling you, an NGO which works in the community, it can also do. How
right.
they do it...
I mean, this
project...
Who are they?
Yeah, I'm just disseminating this information. This project, actually anybody can run it. I mean, you just have to apply to the embassy, US embassy. If you are an NGO and you work in a community, now there is a provision also that you collect the students from various schools. If you don't want to get students from one school, you can collect students from various schools in the vicinity, get them to one place and teach them this English language. The US embassy will fund you, do everything. You just need to collect these people and get them to one place.
Okay, just 1 second. We've got 10 minutes to wrap up. So what I would suggest is, Shubir, if you can share very briefly your potential interventions in these village areas. Suresh, the honor of wrapping up goes to you, so that you can capture what all. And those who want to exchange cards thereafter and express, feel free. Formally we are closed, but informally they can't throw us out.
One more program we are running. It's called Mother Tongue Based Multilingual Early Elementary Education.
I would like to address the issues on the leaving the education part of it, which is not our domain. Basically, the production sectors. I'll divide them into two broad categories. One is the farm sector, other is off-farm sector. Farm sector, definitely we have reached a stage where one hand we are low productive, cropping intensity is very poor, less. If we see most of our tribal areas, probably the cropping intensity will be something within 100 to 120%. I'm talking about Jharkhand, I'm talking about other tribal areas of Odisha. Even you will be surprised to hear that the cropping intensity in those places is low because the post-monsoon moisture content of the soil is very low. They don't have water harvesting mechanism, water irrigation facilities. As a result of that, they are not able to take a second crop. Close to where we are sitting, the story is not different. We have the highest rainfall area. But if you go to Konkan coast, you will find that post-monsoon there is hardly any agricultural activity. You ask where? Why? There's no water. There's scarcity for drinking water. So whom to blame for this? Now, this is one area. Second is, if farm sector has to be made productive and remunerative, then better price realization is very important, which means they should get most of the inputs at a reasonable cost, and they should be able to realize better price for their produce. These are two major areas which is concerning, apart from technology and other things, which definitely goes without saying that the best technology under those agroclimatic conditions, it should reach them. Now, this I am not saying as a benevolent measure that we are giver and they are takers. I think we should realize we have reached a position, if they are not well, we will not be well. They are producing the food grains, that's why we are living in cities. If they stop doing that, we'll be nowhere. And if they leave their land and come to the cities, then imagine what will be the position. So it is something born out of our own selfish interest that we should see that they prosper. Unless we think in that light, it will really not, deliver the goods. Now, if we see how to increase their cropping intensity, particularly the most of the tribal areas which we are discussing, that is our focus, they are by and large hilly, soil is degraded or not so well good compared to the valleys, and rainfall may be many places scanty. So in that situation, the mode of development we have already demonstrated. I would say NABARD has amply demonstrated, not only NABARD, there are many other development programs under which it has been shown. The WADI program and the watershed program, they are really doing wonders. Only thing, it's they have to be replicated. They are already, even in drought-prone areas like Aurangabad and Bidarbha, there are very good models, the Hijre Bazar model and the Raleigh-Gaon-Sindhi we talk about. But what we do, we create models and we worship them. like gods. We only know how to put them on a higher pedestal and worship them. We don't take people there to show them what is happening, how to emulate that and do it in their places. In Hazaribagh area, we have done a number of watershed projects with Pradhan's help. It has shown that an area where the cropping intensity was 110% or less, it has gone up to 160% in 5 years' time. That means that much of additional production. And it is not only that additional production, they have been able to diversify crops. Earlier, which they were using crops which, dryland, typical dryland crops. From there, they have gone into vegetable production. And those who know the vegetable clusters in Gumla, producers organization, they will testify how that village has transformed, that entire area, Gumla district. Vegetable cultivation is, like wildfire, it has grown, and they have formed the producers group. They are able to do marketing. And this sort of program also gets credit support from the banks, and NABARD is also supporting.
In which case, they can also avail of this kind of...
Yeah, exactly.
Off-site, we can discuss this with them.
Yeah, very well. Similarly, I will remind my friends from Jharkhand that the small growers poultry producers organizations which Pradhan has set up, that's a model which is worth emulating, which can be copied. One can go and see and find out how it is working, and the same thing, it can be replicated. Creating a de novo example will be very difficult, but when something is already there, going and seeing, it is easy. Okay, I move. Superd, did I talk about Superd? Okay.
Just to wrap up.
Okay. So Superd is a marketing initiative, again, which is originated in Jharkhand, where they make available the inputs at a controlled price, and they procure the produce from them, cut on the marketing intermediaries, results in better price realization at the farmers' level. So these are examples which needs to be copied and emulated, and probably that there lies the solutions. Coming to off-farm sectors, there's a program called cluster development. Okay. So I just leave with that cluster development. You can explore what is cluster development, and there have been various cluster development programs, including Dokra. So those are the things which are to be seen and probably multiplied. This is what I can say. And to end it, I will say the level of intelligence is very high on the other side also. On this side also, if it is equally matching, then it will be a win-win situation. One example I'll just give. They want to protect their resources, but in empty stomach, you cannot preach them. You have to show them how to protect them, at the same time make economic gains out of it. We have shown in Maharashtra mangrove conservation, where 40% of the mangroves is private mangrove, and which is not giving any economic benefit to the people. They don't believe in the societal benefit and how ecosystem will be enriched and the sea will be better stocked with the mangroves and protect coast will be better protected. They want direct benefit. If they can clear that mangrove, they will be happy and they can do some crop there or some other purposes which is economically beneficial. But we have shown them they can keep the mangrove and do crab farming with it. So while retaining the mangrove, they are doing crab farming and they are reaping a huge benefit. So that's a win-win situation. So we have to sort of engineer all those things and see where there's a conflict situation, how we can convert it into, gainful. Thank you.
Okay, we have now scarcity of time, so I'll try to keep it small.
This was my first exposure to the theme in terms of the tribal welfare, education, skill development. I think we have had a round of excellent initiatives, sharing of good practices by many of you. And towards the end, there has been also an effort towards collaborations, how you can collaborate with each other and take these initiatives to better heights. Having said that, just to sum up, I'm not going to acknowledge anybody individually, but at a broader forum, I was this morning in another similar roundtable forum where there was a topic about malnutrition and how can we have communication for change. And from borrowing from that, the observation that I had there, there's a lot of prescriptive thing that we're sharing with each other, a lot of individual, independent efforts that we're making. And now I can see a lot of inclusivity also is being talked about. How can we collaborate? How can we partner? But the real, in my perspective, the real challenge and effort should be coming in now to move from inclusivity to empowering or to ownership. That should shift. The ownership should be now taken by those who are in need. And we be around there to help them, not driving them forever. Because the sustainability of the effort lies with ownership, not with prescriptive or being inclusive. That's the change that we need to make, be it through education, be it through whatever medium that you want to talk about. But you aim for how can I transfer to ownership and be around to help them rather than do things for them. That's the one. From my personal experience of last 35 years working with people, working on communication and enabling change, all that I have learned that I can share with you is that ownership comes with only one thing, to make them understand what's in it for them. And to do that, a lot of listening is required, not telling. You listen to them, align with them, communicate with them with an alignment, not standing on a pedestal. This is good, this is best practice, do it because I tell you. No. We heard about somebody talking about why should they be displaced from their place of living to a city? Why can't you do this in the tribal areas? So listen to them, and after listening to them, allow them to ask many questions to you till they are convinced, what's in it for me? How does it benefit me? And once that is done, pick up those individuals who show the passion for change, make them the change agents, and through them, drive the ownership to them. You be around, you don't lead the program. So these are some of the thoughts that I thought I can share with you.